familiar faces. We've been here, this is our fourth lecture, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and once again, I'd like to thank Tatiana for arranging this. It's all thanks to her that we're here. I've actually enjoyed it tremendously. My husband makes fun of me. He says that I'm in my element because I love to talk, and you invited me to do all these talks. So I've definitely enjoyed it. We've had a nice first one, nice introduction to the etiology of obesity. Then we had one on the practical aspect of what we do at IDM, which was the ketogenic diet and intermittent fasting. Last time was a very important conversation, not a fun conversation, but a very important one. A lot more science and a lot more medical, I think. Well, not so much what I talked about, but the purpose of what we talked about, the metabolic syndrome and the link with insulin resistance. And we're sort of finishing off, Tatiana asked me how I'd like to finish off, and so I'm finishing off with the one thing that's near and dear to my heart, the reason why I started or I ventured into this low-carb world, kind of stumbled upon it, is because of my own personal experience with PCOS and infertility. So that was 8-plus years ago, maybe 9 years ago now, I don't know. My daughter, my oldest, will be 8 in November, so add a year and 9 months to that is pretty much when this whole thing started for me. So, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that. So this is why we're here today. PCOS and fertility. PCOS stands for polycystic ovary syndrome, and I'll get a little bit more into that. And unfortunately, one of the very predominant symptoms associated conditions to PCOS is infertility and many other things that we'll talk about. And then we'll talk a little bit about the dietary approach, how I got pregnant. Well, I think you all know how I got pregnant, but that's not what I mean. What helped me successfully conceive, and how our program is already helping a lot of women with this condition and is hoping to grow in that field. Dr. Fung and I are working a little bit on that, and I know Megan is going to be implementing a fertility code into our modules and all of our IDM things. So a little outline of our presentation today. I hope to not be blocking this too much, but I will introduce myself properly. I have every time we've come in. I will talk a little bit about IDM, just like I have before, very briefly, the purpose of IDM. And then I'll get into more detail about PCOS, signs and symptoms, treatments, the connection with insulin resistance and the other metabolic syndrome conditions, specifically a little bit about infertility. And at the end, if there's time, I'll touch upon male infertility a little bit, which has nothing to do with PCOS, but I figure that I might as well balance by talking a little bit about that and how maybe the same dietary approach could also help men that have different reasons for being infertile. Obviously, it's not PCOS that men have if they're infertile or otherwise. So a little bit about me. Some of you, like I said, were here before, so you know a little bit. I went to school here in Canada. I have a degree in biology. I went on to do a naturopathic medicine postgraduate degree here in Canada as well. I then left for 10 years. I went back to my home country in Mozambique. And I worked at a multidisciplinary clinic, and because of lack of tools, I guess, I couldn't practice as a naturopath, or at least what we would think of as a naturopath here in Canada. And so I ended up focusing on diet and metabolic syndrome. So right from the get-go, 15 years ago, I had no experience, knew nothing about diet, but I started working with people who wanted dietary support. So I learned a lot along the way, thanks to these wonderful people that I worked with. Currently, I work exclusively for the IDM program as a dietary and fasting coach. I met Dr. Fung a couple years ago at a conference once I had returned to Canada, and they were very, very busy, him and Megan, and I'll introduce the two of them briefly, and they needed, also, there you go, it did it for me. So, exactly who we're talking about, Dr. Jason Fung, who is a kidney specialist here in Canada, in Toronto, and specifically in Scarborough, and Megan Ramos, who's our program director, who works alongside with Dr. Fung, and who, both of them together, co-founded this program, IDM, Intensive Dietary Management Program. At this point, our team has grown extensively. It was the two of them, then I came in, and Megan was a lot, grow our program. The interest was pretty large, and now she's trained a whole bunch of other coaches. So this is part of our team. Our team has actually grown further than this. We have, besides coaches, we have moderators, and we have Megan is creating a whole bunch of associated programs. So a lot of work on Megan's hands as well. So Dr. Fung, some of you may know, has written 3 books. The first book we talked extensively the first time I was in here, The Obesity Code, Unlocking the Secrets of Weight Loss is what the book is called. And it basically talks about the underlying cause of obesity, which we believe to be hormonal, insulin theory, and not the caloric, the good old calorie in, calorie out theory. So this is what The Obesity Code is about. It's basically the backbone of our program. His second book is called A Complete Guide to Fasting, and it's more of a practical book that goes over our different schedules, different intermittent fasting schedules, and that we practice in our program. And then the third book, which is the newer book, is called The Diabetes Code. So in The Diabetes Code, he talks about how, again, insulin resistance is connected to all of these conditions, and how lifestyle, diet and lifestyle, can actually help to prevent and even reverse the course of this disease. So obviously the purpose of IDM is to help people with metabolic syndrome, so people that have hyperinsulinemia, insulin resistance. And so this is expressed as sometimes obesity, prediabetes, type 2 diabetes, fatty liver, hypertension, dyslipidemia, polycystic ovary disease, which is what we're here to talk about today, and the like. So all of these conditions have one thing in common. They're all caused by the same root cause, hyperinsulinemia, which leads to insulin resistance, and it feeds back and forth, and this creates these metabolic syndrome expressions. So our objective with IDM is obviously to lower insulin. If the problem is too much insulin, then we must lower insulin. The solution is to lower insulin. So how do we do this? Fortunately or unfortunately, there's no medication for this. Not even exercise will significantly lower insulin. So what will? A combination of dietary modifications and intermittent fasting. And so this is what we've been doing for the last few years with our clients and patients. So let's talk about specifically PCOS, so polycystic ovary syndrome. Some of you might have heard of PCOS, and many of you have. You either have it or know somebody that has it, because it is the most common endocrine condition in women. At least a third of women worldwide, so at least 30% of women worldwide have PCOS. So why is PCOS so important, such an important topic to discuss, even though it's not discussed nearly as much as it should? Not only does it affect a significant portion of the population, so 30% of women, if not more, during their reproductive years, it significantly impacts the quality of life of women in their reproductive and premenopausal years because of some of the things we're going to discuss. But then it goes on to significantly increase morbidity and mortality post-menopause. So not only does it express itself as a very debilitating, painful, both physically, psychologically, condition, but it increases women's risk for serious health concerns like diabetes, heart disease, obesity, cancer, and other associated conditions. So how is PCOS diagnosed? It's usually diagnosed in premenopausal women, postmenarche, meaning after girls start their period, it can be diagnosed. And the diagnostic criteria are two of the three following, which is polycystic ovaries on ultrasound, so ovaries that show these cystic-like, and I'll show you a picture after, so an ultrasound that shows multiple cysts in the ovaries, hyperandrogenemia, both in labs, so higher androgen levels, higher male hormone levels, both in labs and symptomatically. And then the third is irregular menstruation and ovulation. So any two out of the three is what the current diagnostic criteria is. So if girls, women present with PCO, higher androgen levels, and or irregular menstruation and ovulation. And obviously the third, even though the other two are involved in the infertility problem as well, obviously for people with irregular menstruation and or irregular ovulation, these women will have a harder time getting pregnant, obviously. So what are the signs and symptoms of PCOS initially? So it could be mild to severe. The most common expressions are the expressions of this higher androgen level, this higher male hormone, testosterone in women. And it might not even show up in the lab. It might be normal in the lab, but symptomatically, women might have expressions of the expression of increased androgen. So acne. Did you say something? Yeah, you can see it. Acne, hirsutism, which is abnormal hair growth, male pattern baldness, pain, irregular or absent menstruation, and or obviously ovulation leading to infertility. Acanthosis nigricans, which is it's a dark velvety patchy spots on the body, and this is common in other insulin resistant conditions, not just in PCOS. Weight management concerns. So, and we'll talk a little bit more about weight and PCOS and how these two things are related. It could range anywhere from central obesity, but more particularly central obesity. So the belly fat, which is what a lot of women, obviously men as well, complain. But women hormonally tend to gather more fat around their hips and peripheral obesity, as we call it, whereas men traditionally tend to gather more fat around the midsection. Now, when women have higher than normal male hormones or the expression of male hormones, then they start to premenopause. So we're not talking about postmenopause, which will happen to women naturally. Postmenopause tend to deposit more fat around the midsection, but premenopause. So adolescent girls and women in their reproductive years are showing central obesity, so fat around the viscera, the midsection. And then we've got the concern of irregular glucose metabolism, and there is also a big emotional impact of PCOS, not just because you have young girls walking around with weight concerns and acne and facial hair. You know, this will obviously have an emotional impact on these women growing up. And then later on, they will have the emotional impact of struggling with infertility. And I can speak from experience. But there is also a physiological emotion. It seems that women with PCOS do tend to have a higher degree of depression and anxiety, all things considered. All right. So there is an impact on the sympathetic nervous system as well. So basically, if I show you this diagram, we can look at the root cause of PCOS in a little bit more detail. So right in the center of this diagram, you can see that we have insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia. And for those of you that were here the last time, we talked quite a bit about how insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia is related to metabolic syndrome and is actually the root cause of metabolic syndrome. So particularly in PCOS, we can see from the diagram that this is a vicious cycle. So the fact that women with PCOS have higher levels of insulin, which then will create this polycystic ovaries, that's the diagram there with the cyst and the ovaries, which will then create these hormonal imbalances, higher androgens, so higher male hormones. And that in itself has an effect, but the hyperinsulinemia itself has an effect on the female hormones, so it will disturb menstruation, it will disturb ovulation. And then there's another effect. Sorry, this is set to change automatically. And then there's another direct and indirect effect on the sex hormone binding globulin, which is produced in the liver. So because it goes down, there's less. So this sex hormone binding globulin naturally binds to testosterone. So if the testosterone is not bound to this globulin, then there's more free testosterone around. So these are the androgens, the male hormones that women are expressing. And as you see over here, there is a sympathetic nervous system activity as well. So this is probably why women with PCOS tend to have a higher degree of emotional concerns as well. And then this all feeds back on the adipose tissue, and then you've got the central obesity, which then creates more hyperinsulinemia and more insulin resistance, and there's just a vicious feedback cycle all the time. So this is what I was talking about here. So you cycle between a higher insulin response to foods, leading to this hyperinsulinemia, so a higher insulin state. And insulin, I know I'm getting right to it, and that's because the last time we were here, we talked quite a lot about what is insulin and how we produce insulin and what foods will produce more insulin. And we'll get to talking a little bit about the food and the fasting and how that helps to lower insulin, but we talked quite a bit about this last time. So this cycle leading to the hyperinsulinemia, which then leads to abnormal hormone concentrations, including the sex hormone binding globulin in the liver and higher production of male hormones. And then this leads to the polycystic ovaries, and that has an effect on the hormones there, and it affects the menstruation, ovulation, and then the sympathetic nervous system, as we said. And then the fat storage leading to that central obesity, and this vicious cycle just keeps going over and over again. And this starts pre-puberty, post-puberty, throughout the reproductive years, and it will cause all of these symptoms that we just talked about, the acne and the hirsutism, the male pattern baldness, the pain and the irregular menstruation and the infertility and all of these things. And later on, unfortunately, onto even more severe and worrisome conditions like diabetes, cardiovascular disease, cancer, and all the other associated conditions. So, this is how PCOS expresses itself. So how is it treated in the medical community? So it's a common, as we said, it's a very common condition. Doctors are familiar with PCOS. A lot of women are given this diagnosis. It is a diagnosis, as they call it, diagnosis of exclusion, which means that you have to exclude other considered more serious conditions before you can give the diagnosis of PCOS. But after all that, women are diagnosed with PCOS, and the conventional treatment focuses mostly, like most other conventional medical treatments, focus mostly on symptoms. So if women have acne, they're given medication for acne. If women have irregular menstruation, they're put on the pill to help regulate their menstruation. And if women have fertility issues, they're put through fertility treatment. So none of these medications, unfortunately, treat the root cause of PCOS. So if the root cause of PCOS, as we've seen and as we believe it to be, is insulin resistance, then of course the optimal treatment for PCOS should be to reverse insulin resistance. But that's not what we are doing. Furthermore, diet didn't used to be considered an important therapy for PCOS. But ever since insulin resistance has been shown to be at the core of PCOS, the pathophysiology of PCOS, now diet has come in to play even as a first-line treatment, meaning that doctors will tell women with PCOS, as soon as they're diagnosed with PCOS, you must watch your diet, you must lose weight, you must exercise. So this is the conventional dietary advice that's given. Still, the conventional dietary advice, whether it be for PCOS or for any other weight concern, is the advice has been to tell women to decrease their calories and exercise more. So we call that the calorie in, calorie out, eat less, move more approach. And we talked a lot about this in the very first lecture that I did here, the one we talked about the obesity, the etiology of obesity, and that's what Dr. Fung's first book is all about, The Obesity Code, and why the calorie in, calorie out therapy has not worked. Reducing calories and exercising more has not worked. It has not put people in a better place. It's probably put them in a worse place. But the main point here is that it doesn't address the root cause of any of these problems, obesity, PCOS, diabetes, because the root cause is insulin resistance. Reducing your calories and exercising more is not going to reduce your insulin. All right, so this is the main problem. So myself, I always use myself as an example. When I was diagnosed with PCOS, I was actually, and I will talk a little bit about that, I actually was not overweight when I was diagnosed with PCOS. I was starting to develop the central obesity, but I wasn't overweight. And my doctor, this was, again, 10 years ago, close to 10 years ago, he did say to me that day that I was, he actually, right, it's one of those things that you would never really forget, right? Because I weighed 50 kilos, and he said, the next time I see you, you're probably going to weigh 80 kilos. And that's 30 kilos. That's 70 pounds. And so the connection is there. They are aware of it. But that's where the conversation ended. He didn't give me an optimal diet to do. He didn't tell me what to eat. He just told me that I needed to, that I was going to be obese and I was going to have to lose weight. But the doctors that do, conventionally, when they do talk to women about weight and PCOS, they usually tell them, eat less, move more. That has been the conventional advice for the last 50 plus years. So the one thing that's very interesting in my research that I've done with PCOS is to look at sort of there's very little research, first of all. Let's put it this way. There's very little interest and very little research on this concern, even though it's a major concern. Particularly, the biggest gap in our literature with PCOS seems to be the dietary advice. So it is known at this moment in time that women need to address the diet and they need to lose weight, but there is absolutely no consensus about what the diet, the optimal diet should be, except that women should lose weight. Women with PCOS should lose weight. So when I was looking into this, you would think that if the medical community is recommending that women with PCOS eat less, then it would make sense to assume that women with PCOS actually eat more, right? If you're going to tell somebody to eat less, then I'm assuming that you think that they eat more than they should. And the second thing is the conventional calorie in, calorie out theory, eat less, move more, is based on a low calorie diet. So that's what we talked about again the last time as well, right? The calorie in, calorie out. So low calorie diet. The low calorie diet that has been followed and in use for 50 plus years is a low fat diet. So if you're going to tell a woman with PCOS, eat less, and eat less fat, then I'm assuming that you think that women with PCOS eat more and they eat more fat. But in fact, that could not be further from the truth. So what has been shown in research that has been done with women with PCOS and their dietary history and their dietary habits is actually that women with PCOS don't eat more and they don't eat more fat. They just eat more often and they eat more sugar naturally, just like everybody else with insulin resistance. So again, you're telling these same women to basically do exactly what's going to cause them more harm, what's going to increase their insulin resistance by telling them to eat smaller meals, more times a day, eat less fat. Automatically, they're gonna eat more sugar. So this is something that is important, because if we're going to help these women, we're gonna have to use a method that's going to work, that's going to have results. So, interestingly, I myself was prescribed metformin a few years back, thanks to a very smart doctor, actually, because the second time I tried to get pregnant, I was in a very bad place metabolically, and even what I had tried before to get pregnant the first time didn't work. And then she said to me, well, of course you're not going to get pregnant, even with a fertility treatment. So a little bit of my own background here, as I said to you guys, I started all of this about 10 years ago. My husband and I were trying to get pregnant, right? Well, I was in my late 20s, probably 29, 30 at the time, just over 30, I guess. I'm 40 now, so 10 years ago. And a year later, I was not pregnant. I wasn't really sure what was going on, but all I knew was that I wasn't pregnant. So anyway, a lot of pushing up from my side, trying to convince my doctor to look further into it. I felt like my doctor was sort of just disregarding the whole thing. I was thin, I was healthy. He just didn't look enough into it. But once I did convince him to look more and more into it, and we did ultrasounds and blood tests, we discovered that I had PCOS. So again, lean woman with PCOS. But what I did have,
blood test showed what kind of abnormalities.
I have irregular blood sugar concerns. I still have that. So I'm not diabetic, but I was pre-diabetic. Mm-hmm. The ultrasound showed that I had, and that's how he diagnosed me. The ultrasound showed that I had polycystic ovaries. Mm-hmm. all right? And I had all the expressions of the extra male hormones. I had the hirsutism, I had the acne, and the one thing that convinced him to check all this was because my hair was starting to fall out, so the male pattern baldness. So at this point, I had all the expressions, but because I didn't have, I wasn't overweight, I think he dismissed it. So that's another important thing too. To get, not all women, and I'll talk a little bit more about obesity and PCOS. So anyway, this to say that I was diagnosed with it. He gave me fertility treatments. The fertility treatments didn't work. My husband refused to do IVF, which was kind of our saving grace, I guess you would say. I probably would have never gone down this road had we done IVF. And his logic, which is very logical, and you'll see, we'll talk a little bit about that, but his logic was, you're 30 years old. If you're not getting pregnant, there's obviously something wrong. So yeah. Why would we do IVF? That makes no sense. We need to figure out what's wrong. So because of that, and because me, like every other woman that wants to get pregnant, I wanted to get pregnant yesterday, not in a year from now or 2 years from now, whenever they diagnosed me with whatever or gave me some kind of treatment and he wouldn't do IVF, I then started to utilize the tools that I had. And I knew as a naturopath, and because I'd already been working at this time for 5 years probably, I knew that my patients somehow got pregnant when they started my diet, this detox diet that I called it. It was just a very strict low-carb diet. So I was known, funny enough, in where I practiced, people came to me for fertility concerns, and then lo and behold, here I am having the same concern. So I went home, he wouldn't do the IVF, and I put myself on the strictest of all my detoxes, which basically was just a very strict low, so what we today call a ketogenic diet, a very strict low-carb diet, and I was pregnant, I think, within a month or two. I know it was immediately after. Had my child. Unfortunately, myself, like every other woman that I know that has had these concerns and does whatever to get pregnant, I didn't follow anything during my pregnancy. I went on to eat my chocolates and drink my Coca-Cola. And so, of course, my insulin resistance got worse and worse and worse. So if I go back a little bit, you think, so why does this thin person develop PCOS? You know, what was happening? What was happening is that my dietary habits were tremendously bad. My whole life. I never had a full meal my entire life. I snacked all day long and I ate tons of sugar. And so I didn't express it as general obesity, but obviously that extra sugar was going into my inner organs and I was developing central obesity, visceral obesity. And that affected me tremendously. And it still affects me tremendously today. So when I do go off the rails, and I do, what happens is I get my blood pressure goes up, so I don't gain a tremendous amount of weight, but my blood pressure goes up. I for sure see my little, I can see it, it's in the belly, I can see it. My blood pressure goes up, I check my blood sugars post-meal, and they are tremendously high. So this is just one expression of metabolic syndrome. So I've said this to you, and when we were here last time, that all of these conditions, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, even cancer, we talked about Alzheimer's, now we're talking about PCOS, these are all the same disease on the spectrum.
The connection between it. Yeah.
The connection is the insulin resistance. The root cause of all of these is the exact same. Mm-hmm. The expression of it is different, but they're all on the same spectrum. Or not on the same spectrum, sorry, they're all a different spectrum of the same disease. So that's where I am, right? But I have the exact same thing, or at least the root cause, and we'll talk about that in the next slide. The root cause of my disease is the exact same as a very good friend of mine that I have that weighs 400 pounds. Yet he doesn't have hypertension, he doesn't have diabetes, but he weighs 400 pounds. But the one thing that the two of us have in common is that we're insulin resistant. All right, so we talked a lot about insulin resistance last time. So I was talking about metformin and how I was put on metformin. So first time around, I got pregnant, lovely. I was very lucky. It was pure fluke. Not so much fluke. I knew there was something behind the diet. I didn't have any idea why. I just knew that women got pregnant, and I thought, if that's what I'm going to have to go with, that's what I'm going to do. I did it. I lost in 1 month probably 7 pounds. Remember, I was tiny to begin with. But I lost the 7 pounds, I did the low carb, high fat diet, and I got pregnant. And then I forgot about it. I just threw it out the window, don't need to do this, I'm now pregnant, who cares about it? And then I had every single pregnancy complication probably you can think of, and we'll talk a little bit about PCOS in pregnancy. So there's issue number one, infertility. Women with PCOS having a hard time getting pregnant. Issue number two is, what happens when PCOS women do get pregnant? There's a whole bunch of issues there. Second time around, my doctor, a good friend of mine actually, not the same first doctor, but another doctor, I was put on the fertility treatments, second time didn't work, and she said to me, Nadia, of course you're not going to get pregnant with the Clomifen, and I'll talk a little bit about the fertility treatments. You are insulin resistant. So she knew 10 years ago, well, I guess the second time around wasn't 10 years ago, 5 years ago. My little one is going to be 5 this year, so 6 years ago. She knew then that PCOS and insulin resistant were, she's a gynecologist, she was my gynecologist at the time in Mozambique. She knew of the connection, and she said metformin might help. So some of you might know the drug metformin is a diabetic drug. Mm-hmm. I took the metformin and I got pregnant. So there's something with the mechanism of action, obviously, of metformin that helps women with PCOS get pregnant. And if you, just a little bit of background about metformin, it's not a hypoglycemic medication, so it's not a drug that lowers blood sugars. It's a drug that makes your cells and organs more sensitive to insulin. So it helps to lower your insulin resistance. It makes you more sensitive. So if metformin can do it, and diet can do it, then this tells us a whole lot about PCOS and infertility.
I have a question. Does metformin have any side effects?
Yeah, lots. All medications have side effects. And this is why we move on to medication is probably not the key for women with PCOS. And yes, it does. It has tons of side effects. But it's probably one of the most generally well tolerated diabetic drug, and it's probably, not probably, I think likely it is the first line treatment for PCOS, for diabetes, but not PCOS. It is used in some women with PCOS, and it's starting to be used more and more frequently. So again, root cause, let's not forget the root cause of, if the root cause of PCOS is insulin resistance, then this is what we should be treating, right? So how do we treat this? How do we treat the root cause of PCOS? How do we address this? So as I was, you know, I've said this enough times, and I think I hope that I have anyway, that I've made you, helped you to realize how important this condition is and how common it is. And really, it truly has not been given enough attention in research, in the medical community, and the current treatments for PCOS don't address this insulin resistant condition. So how do you reverse insulin resistance? And I know we talked about this in the other three lectures in a lot more detail. But if the problem is too much insulin, as I said, then we must lower insulin. And how do we lower insulin? We eat foods that are lower in carb, because carbs are the one food that raise your insulin the most. We eat less often. This is called intermittent fasting, because every time you do eat, you raise your insulin. We should eat foods that are higher in fat, because not only will they help to mitigate the insulin response, so fat, fiber, and vinegar, we talked about this last time, fat, fiber, and vinegar as being the three protective nutrients.
Apple vinegar or just white vinegar?
Any vinegar. We do recommend apple cider vinegar, but I think any vinegar will have a mitigating, it will mitigate the insulin response. And also fat ensures proper nutrition, number one, so lots of good nutrients in fattier foods, but also it ensures satiety. So if you eat more fat, you're going to eat less often. Remember that eating more often, the snacking, is really the issue here for women with PCOS and people with insulin resistance. And then again, remember that exercise in and of itself doesn't actually have a direct impact on insulin resistance, and it doesn't actually help women to lose weight. Women or men lose weight, and we talked extensively about this in one of the lectures here too. So of course it has many, many benefits, and by no means am I ever going to, you're going to hear me ever say that you shouldn't exercise. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is it's not in and of itself going to help women with PCOS. So for those that do exercise, you must keep in mind that you must eat more. Okay, and this is called accommodation. We talked about this last time too. But eating more doesn't mean, shouldn't mean eating more often. It just means eating more when you do eat. So if we lower insulin, then hopefully you get into this fat-burning ketogenic mode, you revert this vicious cycle, you lower the androgens, the male hormones, you regulate the menstruation, you regulate the ovulation, and hopefully women will get pregnant. This is, it is a direct effect. It's not indirect, it is direct, right? This is what's causing the issue. So let's talk a little bit about obesity. This is an important point. Obesity does not cause PCOS, and PCOS does not cause obesity. All right? Not all women with PCOS are obese, and not all obese women have PCOS. This is very important. What do they have in common? The root cause is the same. So the reason why you see that 70 to 80% of women with PCOS are obese is because the root cause is the same. Insulin resistance will lead to both PCOS and obesity. All right, so remember, I was a thin, very thin actually, extremely thin individual with PCOS, but I had the central obesity. I had fat in my viscera, in my organs, all right? So having said that, it's important to note that women with PCOS that are obese have a much more serious expression of PCOS. So obesity aggravates all the signs and symptoms of PCOS, all right? So you'll have more complications, both pre-pregnancy, post-pregnancy, during pregnancy. You will have more abnormal hormone levels. You will have all of these things that are there. You'll have fertility will be a bigger issue, obviously, central obesity. If you're generalized obesity and you have PCOS, the central obesity will be a bigger issue. More androgens, less of the sex hormone binding globulin. So it makes everything worse. So that's important too. So if you do have somebody with PCOS who is obese, that's an even more serious and aggravated condition. So the obesity must be addressed. The weight must be addressed as well. And it's addressed by the exact same method. You lower insulin resistance. So let's talk a little bit about how infertility is being treated in the conventionally, really. Women with PCOS with infertility actually account for over 80% of all the non-ovulatory infertility. So basically what this is saying is that a lot of fertility clinics are making a lot of money because of PCOS women, all right? Most of the women with PCOS walking into these fertility clinics, most of the women with infertility walking into their doctor's office and later on to fertility clinics have PCOS. It is the most common cause of non-ovulatory. There are other types of infertility, but this is the most common cause of the non-ovulatory infertility. There's blockage infertility, tubal infertility. There are other, you know, women who've had, unfortunately, ovarian cancer. There are other causes of infertility. PCOS is not the only cause, but it accounts for the majority of. So what is the conventional approach? And I started down this path myself. Couldn't get pregnant. A year of being unsuccessful at conceiving when a couple has been practicing unprotected sex. I don't think that's the right way to say it. But anyway, after a year, you're considered infertile. And so then you go on this route. The first line treatment for ovulation stimulators is Clomifen citrate. That's what I took, Clomid. Very common. It's been used since the 60s. It's not a new drug, but it's still the first line treatment. The success rate is about 20%. I mean, it's not nothing to write home about, but it does help some women ovulate. And obviously, if they ovulate, the chances of fertility of conceiving are higher. If Clomifen doesn't work, they move on to Letrozole, which is another fertility ovulation stimulator, which unfortunately comes with its own side effects. One of the concerns is that it could potentially cause birth defects. So of course, there's concerns here all around. Whenever this lady here asked about, oh, does metformin have side effects? All medications have side effects, all right? So anytime people go down this path, you have to know Clomifen is gonna have certain side effects, Letrozole is gonna have others. Gonadotropins are third line treatment because these are injections. This is the women that you see getting ready for IVF, right? They're injecting gonadotropins onto their belly. Not fun, painful, and of course that comes with side effects. Metformin is not a fertility drug. It's the diabetic drug that I talked about a little while ago, but it is used in women with PCOS that are infertile, very commonly used. And of course, when none of these pills and injections work, then people go on to the more invasive procedures like IUI and IVF. IUI is in utero insemination, meaning that they take the sperm from the male counterpart and they inject it directly into the uterus of the woman. Some with ovulation stimulation, and then they do that. IVF is a whole other process. You take the egg from the girl and the sperm from the boy, and you put it in a petri dish, and you make a little embryo, and then you put the embryo back. So this is very invasive, very expensive. I think that they averaged out the cost per live birth to be about $243,000. So that means that of all the IVFs that they do, right, if you take, it costs $10,000 to $20,000, I think, per round for IVF, about that, right, depending on where you go in the world. Canada actually has at least Ontario, I shouldn't say Canada, where women up until, I think, the age of 42 get their first round of IVF paid for by OHIP. So there's a lot of...
Women after 42, like 44, 43.
Are you asking me?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. This is an aside. I'm not, sorry. I'm actually not in the fertility...
business.
Not business, but in this, but you know, I'm interested, so I hear about this stuff, and I think it's interesting, and I have nothing against IVF. I think that a baby is always a welcome miracle when people want a baby, right? So the reason why I'm talking about this, and I'll explain at the end of this slide, is because there are some concerns about stimulating pregnancy in women with PCOS, and I was one of these women. So anyway, IVF is, what I meant to say is, it's not just intrusive, it's also very expensive. And it has a very huge physical and emotional debilitating impact on families that go through this, because it is not, as you can imagine, a fun process. And then to go through all that and not be pregnant, and then to do it a second time and a third time, and families will go through this forever and ever. So the average, it seems, per live birth is $240,000. And that's just money, right? There's a lot of other concerns here. So prohibitive costs and risks. There are some very big concerns with any ovulation stimulation. One of them is called OHSS, which basically is, it could be a lethal condition in women that are, once the ovaries get hyperstimulated, women can have a whole range of, from bloating to respiratory concerns. So it's a severe condition that can happen. It's rare, but it can happen anytime there's ovulation stimulation. I actually know one case, somebody, one person. But anyway, it is a possibility. The major issue with fertility treatments, as I've said a number of times, is that it doesn't actually address or treat the root cause of PCOS, right? So we're putting a band-aid. Dr. Fong actually used this expression in one of the things that we're writing together. He basically said, you're basically putting a band-aid over a bullet hole. And that's the truth of the matter. Any of these, the pill for irregular menstruation or fertility treatments, you're not addressing the real issue. Even if you get a woman with PCOS, even if a woman with PCOS does conceive, she's not addressing any of the other issues. And the ones that she's having during her reproductive years, but she's not preventing the ones that are coming, right? Because these things are coming. The diabetes, the cardiovascular disease, the cancer. Unfortunately, they're there. They're there. By the time women reach menopause, women with PCOS, they will have some, if not all, of these expressions. This is what I had to look forward to and still do. I still have to be aware of that and prevent that from happening. So this is the major issue. It doesn't address the root cause, and it doesn't address the associated concerns, the obesity, right, and the metabolic syndrome that's still to come. So as I was saying to this lady here, there are major concerns about artificially helping women with PCOS getting pregnant, because one, you're not treating the root cause, but two, women with PCOS that do get pregnant, if they don't address the insulin resistance, will have much more complicated pregnancies. And this is important. This for me is probably the most important. Of course, I would say we all, because not everybody wants to have babies, but of course, when you want to have a baby, you want to have a baby. That's an obvious, right? But you have to realize that if you have PCOS, it's not just about having a baby. It's about making sure that you get well, improve your metabolic syndrome before you get pregnant, hopefully, or least, if not before, then at least during the pregnancy. So what happens when a woman with PCOS gets pregnant? She has a much greater risk, obviously, of infertility. We already know this, but of complications, right? Spontaneous abortion, very common, especially if they're obese. So again, everything that I'm about to say, remember that if they have PCOS and they are obese, then it's that risk is even higher. So if they have PCOS, there's a higher risk of spontaneous abortion, much higher risk if they are obese with PCOS. Gestational diabetes, much higher risk if they have obesity and PCOS. Pregnancy-induced hypertension, I'm going to check. This is all the stuff that I had. Preeclampsia, check. Diabetes postpartum, check. So this is all a concern. So what happened with me was that, yes, I got pregnant. I did the diet for a month, lucky me, got pregnant, and then I threw the diet out the window, right? So my pregnancy was complicated, my postpartum period was complicated. I actually should add postpartum depression onto there because insulin resistance seems to be related to that, and I had postpartum depression. So not only is the woman at a higher risk for all of these things, but unfortunately the fetus is too. So fetus or babies born to women with PCOS, obviously, the higher spontaneous abortion rate, that's to the fetus, obviously, and to the babies. Babies born to women with PCOS are born either smaller or larger size. So both these, the two ends of the same spectrum, have complications. And they're shown to be related to metabolic syndrome later in life. So babies that are born small and babies that are born too big are shown to later on in life have a higher rate of metabolic syndrome when they're older. These babies tend to have more visits to the neonatal intensive care unit, higher neonatal mortality rates, so death in babies born to these women, and higher risk of developing metabolic syndrome later on. So both girls and boys born to women with PCOS have a higher rate of PCOS for girls, diabetes, infants, and adult obesity and heart disease. All right, so there's obviously an issue there. So just in our fertility treatments, some of them, IVF, has taken, you know, leaps, bounds. This has grown. It's a big business. And it seems that women with PCOS actually have a higher rate of fertility when they do PCOS versus the other women. So remember that 80% of the fertility cases in these clinics are PCOS women. But the other ones that have these tubal infertility and all these other reasons for infertility, they're not as successful getting pregnant as women with PCOS. Women with PCOS that do IVF can be pretty successful. But then what happens? How do you prevent all these things from happening, which are pretty serious? Mm-hmm. So it seems that the studies that are being done on metformin, so metformin being used, being taken by these women pre-pregnancy, so pre-conception, seems to lower the rates of all of these things. So not only does it help improve fertility, but it lowers the rate of pregnancy-induced complications. Why? Because of the insulin resistance. So we should learn from the metformin, because if you can go through this preconception therapy with women with PCOS through dietary changes, proper dietary changes, then you're likely going to not only help the fertility, but you're going to help reduce all of these complications, not just for the woman, but for the child. All right?
Yeah. There's a herb called golden seal, mm-hmm. which has the same effect as metformin, mm-hmm. but it doesn't have the side effects. It's a herb.
Great. So maybe a great adjunct. I'm using metformin not to say that it's the sort of holy grail. I don't think the metformin is actually the solution to the problem, because although it does help the cells become more sensitive, it doesn't reverse the insulin resistance. So, but I think that. And I think that a lot of times people are looking for alternatives like herbs, and I don't think, like acupuncture. I used to do acupuncture a lot for my fertility patients, and it did help. But it, again, doesn't address the root cause. So as an adjunct, great. But if we're going to ignore the root cause and the diet, then again, we're putting a band-aid over a bullet hole, right? So we must treat the root cause, both to get pregnant and to help with pregnancy. So prior to pregnancy, this is key. If I can, maybe some of you this will be helpful to you or to others that you know, but if I could drive one point home, that would be the one, is that it's not about getting pregnant. not just about getting pregnant, all right? It's about preventing these very serious concerns during pregnancy, post-pregnancy, and post-menopause, all right? Best case scenario, you're doing the treatments, you're reversing insulin resistance and the hyperinsulinemia before pregnancy. So how do we address the insulin resistance? A lower carb, higher fat diet. We talked a little bit about that, and obviously intermittent fasting, eating less often. These will have a much higher, as we were just saying, will have a much higher impact and greater success than metformin or any other alternative medicine. And always address obesity with the weight loss. And again, you can achieve weight loss by reversing insulin resistance through a low carb, high fat diet and intermittent fasting. So this is where the ketogenic diet comes in, which is what I practice personally and professionally, a strict low-carb diet below 20 grams of net carbs a day, moderate amounts of protein, and this is figured out based on body weight, and fat to surplus. So there's no limit to fat except to eat to satiety. This is what a ketogenic diet is. It gets people into a ketogenic state, and we talked a lot about this in the other lectures. Lower insulin, higher ketones. Lower insulin, fat burning, release. Higher insulin, weight gain, retain. So we're trying to do, a ketogenic state automatically means that you're in a lower insulin state. So you're trying to achieve this lower insulin, higher ketone state. Intermittent fasting, whether you're practicing proper meal timing or alternate day fasts or extended fasts. On an eating day, the focus should be on 2 to 3 large meals a day, no snacking. This is key. We talked about this in great detail last time. There are lots of schedules for intermittent fasting and extended fasting. Somebody here today just told me she's on the 10th day of a fast. Mm-hmm. She's one of Dr. Fung's victims. She's followed in clinic and, you know, doing all the proper, I'm sure, she's being shadowed, I hope, appropriately. Anyway, alternate day fasts are one of the dietary common intermittent fasting schedules. Extended fast means anything 2+ days of fasting, like one of the ladies here is doing. We talk about hydration, so water and electrolytes. If you're going to venture on any of this, if you're going to try any of these schedules, it's obviously important that you get informed and hopefully you're getting some expert guidance. I've got a little comment there at the bottom, because obviously at some point this is gonna, if you haven't already thought about it, you're gonna think about it. Oh, so you're trying to get women pregnant by fasting, but couldn't that be dangerous? We don't get people to fast, or I don't anyway, and we don't in our program. You don't get people to fast when they're pregnant or when they're breastfeeding, even though we all fast. We all fast. Everybody naturally fasts overnight in between meals. There's periods of fasting and periods of feasting. So there are schedules that should be followed. And when myself, for example, when I am trying to help somebody in their fertility journey, there's a schedule that I follow. There's a fasting schedule that people are more free to do pre-ovulation, and then there's a different schedule that they do post-ovulation. So it's not something that I haven't thought about, and you probably have as well, reading this.
Fasting means no food, no drink, or just drink?
We don't do dry fasts. We do water and electrolytes. Mm-hmm. There are other fasting liquids as well. So in one of the other lectures, it was more of a practical lecture, and so we did talk a lot more about that. You can probably find the lecture online on my website and YouTube. So when I did this lecture for somebody asked me to do this lecture previously, so I didn't actually do this lecture for this specifically for here. I've done this lecture before, and they asked me for PCOS resources. There aren't many, okay? There are some, but there aren't many, and unfortunately there aren't many, if any at all, that I would recommend. Just because, as I've said from the beginning, medication doesn't do it, and most of the studies are done on medication. The recommended diet won't do it, because they're recommending a low-calorie, low-fat diet, more meals throughout the day, eat less, move more. That's not going to help women with PCOS. So even though there isn't a whole bunch of good resources, we have lots and lots, we and many other people that we have had the pleasure of talking with and working with, have lots of clinical evidence that a lower-carb diet and intermittent fasting can has helped women in their fertility journey and reversing or helping to manage PCOS. So I know of one fertility doctor in particular that actually uses low-carb diet as an adjunct, and you can look him up on the Diet Doctor website, dietdoctor.com. That's a great reference there. I personally have a blog. I write a lot about PCOS and fertility on my website. And I'm going to repeat this, and I'm glad that this lady brought it up, but if we understand the mode of action of metformin, we can clearly understand why this diet and the intermittent fasting could be helpful for women with PCOS. So as I said at the very beginning, if we have, and we only have a couple of minutes, but as I said, if we had a little bit of time, I would touch upon the male infertility. We have no males here today. We did last time, and I just thought it would be fair if I did mention this. It's obviously not my expertise. I don't actually actively go out there and try to help men with infertility, but I have to tell you that both in my private practice, when I did have a private practice, which I don't anymore, and now through IDM, I do get, IDM is a group program, which means that we talk in a group setting. There's men and women, and it's very rare. Women are very open often about their concerns. Men, I find, are not so much, so it's not something that openly comes up. But both in my private practice, when I used to speak to people one-on-one, and even now that I speak to groups, I get all kinds of emails from men saying, you know, an aside, you know, because these are men that either have obesity, diabetes, some expression of metabolic syndrome. And I will get emails of people, of men, because they have no issue sharing that with me, they just don't want to share it with the group, that their libido has improved, erectile dysfunction, which has often been present for years, and this is very common, will disappear. So when I looked into this, because I wanted to explain this to you guys, right, a little bit, there are obviously male infertility is 40, they average it to be about 40 to 50% of all the infertile cases. So when a man and woman, a couple, when they're going through their infertility struggles, they don't look at just the women. They assume that there's as much of a chance that the man has the infertility issue as the woman. So there are pre-testicular causes and then there's post-testicular causes, if you're going to divide the male infertility in half. Pre-testicular means that there is an issue outside of the testes, all right, leading, so they call that secondary hypogonadism. So the problem outside of the testes, likely in the hypothalamus, I think, and I have this in my notes, and one of the other glands. But anyway, the most likely cause is probably obesity. Celiac disease, which I was surprised to find, is actually a cause of, can be a cause of reversible male infertility. When put on a gluten-free diet, this infertility seems to reverse itself. So there's a lot to be said there.
Yeah. I was going to say, genetically modified foods, they've done a lot of studies that it could cause infertility.
Well, I'm certain of it.
And there's a lot of spices, a lot of additives and foods that we eat, and we're not aware that they're genetically modified. So it would be a good idea to find out what those spices, the different names of those spices are when you're buying foods. Also, pesticides, all these things can contribute to infertility.
Yeah, and these might be major or minor, but there are, you know, but a major cause of infertility is insulin resistance in both men and women, right? So I think addressing all, for sure, I am very weary of GMO foods, and of course we're exposed to pesticides all over, but you know, I like you guys, probably do my best. Like I personally try as best as I can to not use perfumes, for example. And I make a big deal about that with my husband because he loves cologne. And so it's a big, and we have two little kids. I just don't want them exposed to that. But we are exposed to a lot of these things. So anyway, and then there's the post-testicular causes. So things that actually affect the testicles. And impotence and erectile dysfunction, as we talked about. The most common cause, and this is any reference that I've looked up for impotence and erectile dysfunction, they say is metabolic syndrome. Isn't that interesting? And what causes metabolic syndrome? Insulin resistance. Right? So there's obvious potential benefit in doing a lower carb diet and intermittent fasting in both men and women with fertility concerns and many, many other concerns. Libido is a big one. So, you know, it's not a, maybe not a, not a cause for infertility, but it obviously can be an obstacle. And so I find that, as I said, a lot of times men will say, my libido came back, right? Which is a big thing for couples and men in general. And they'll say, the big thing, and I've heard this for 15 years, is that as soon as men are put on these lower carb diets, their erectile dysfunction goes away. This is pretty big. I personally don't focus on male health, but I think it's a big thing. So some references here, IDM program, website, my website. I've got lots of recipes. You know, I didn't go into the ketogenic diet here, and I didn't go into intermittent fasting because we did do that another time, but it's on my website, the Diet Doctor website. That's one of the doctors I work with a lot, and he's got for sure 100% the best low carb website out there. So if you want recipes, if you want videos of experts talking about low carb, that's probably the one place to go. All right, and that was it. So I didn't go over by 30 minutes like the last time. It was much, much better. Last time was a lot more, we talked about metabolic syndrome, so all these very serious conditions.